That's right.
I need help from my friends.
Please come to order. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. Good morning. Welcome to the joint meeting of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County and the St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission, this date, Tuesday, November 13th, 2018. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other commissioners and our county administrator. Tom Jarboe, who represents the 1st Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. Germain, is unable to be here today. He's in some kind of training, so he can't be here. Representing the 2nd Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown, Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
John O'Connor, who represents the 3rd Commissioner District, which includes Straw Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, and Mechanicsville, is unfortunately causing sick this morning, so he won't be here. Representing the 4th Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Southern California, Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan.
Order, folks.
And down at the end there is Dr. Rebecca Bridges, our county administrator. Ms. Amy Carter, our video media producer, is filming this meeting today for broadcast on Friday, November 16th at 6:30 p.m. and again on Sunday, November 18th at noon. This meeting can also be viewed on the county's YouTube website. Sitting across from me is John Carey, chair of the Metropolitan Commission. Commissioner Carey, would you like to introduce your other commissioners and some opening remarks?
I would. Thank you, Commissioner Guy. Good morning. I'm John Carey, chairman of the Metropolitan Commission, and I represent the 2nd and 9th election districts. I would like to take an opportunity to welcome everyone to our joint meeting and provide a brief introduction of the Metropolitan Commission board members present today. Beside me to my right, I have Vice Chairman Brian Barthelme, representing the 4th and 5th election districts.
Good morning.
To his right, we have Commissioner Russ Russell, representing the 3rd election district.
Good morning.
And to his right, we have Commissioner Mike Thompson, representing the 6th election district. To his right, we have Commissioner Bob Russell, representing the 7th election district.
Good morning.
And our newest, actually Russ Russell is our newest member, I believe. Commissioner Keith Fairfax, representing the 8th election district.
Good to be here.
To his, Commissioner Gaskin, Alice Gaskin, who represents the 1st election district, is unable to attend today due to a planned medical procedure, and we wish her the best of luck with that. In addition to the members of the MedCom senior management team, also present today is George Erickson, all the way to Commissioner Fairfax is right, MedCom Executive Director, and Chris Beaver, MedCom Legal Counsel. Mm-hmm. Thank you for taking the time to meet with us today.
Well, thank you, Commissioner Beaver. Before we start with the presentation today, let's all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Please face the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
At this time, we'll get right into our agenda. We thank the Commission Metropolitan for being here today and joining us in this joint meeting to go over the various issues that we move forward. At this time, I think we'll go right into the rate study update.
Good morning.
I'm very sorry to see your face on the other side of the aisle, but
it's good to see your face anyway.
We are glad to have her.
And she's now in the financial helm of the MedCom.
Right.
We can discuss the Metropolitan Commission hiring and recruiting practices.
Well, good morning, everyone. In 2014, a water and sewer rate study was completed at the request of the Metropolitan Commission. The rate study consisted primarily of a revenue sufficiency and rate structure analysis, which provided specific recommendations related to the pricing of water and sewer service in the Commission's service area. As part of the original rate study, a financial management plan developed for MetCom reflected a 5-year rate adjustment plan that sought to meet the projected annual cost requirements of each respective system while establishing reserves to recommended levels by the end of the 5-year period. The rate of increase for each of the past 5 years was 3.75% for sewer and 3% for water. Upon completion of the 5-year plan, it was projected that MetCom would be able to operate with very modest annual increases to keep pace with the cost inflation. The purpose of this addendum seeks to add context, analysis, and narrative to a select set of issues relating to MetCom's operating utility rates since the completion of the 2014 study. And in preparation of the fiscal year 2020 budget, we are in the final stages of the addendum, which does provide support of MetCom's goal to be able to operate with very modest annual increases. I'd like to introduce Kyle Stevens of Stantec, and he's going to go through the presentation this morning of the rate study addendum.
Perfect. Thank you. Welcome. Thank you so much, Commissioners, for having me here today. Look forward to going through the addendum. You know, the name in the corner is Stantec. I was actually Burton and Associates back in 2014 and was on the original team that did the rate study back there. So today I'd like to do a short presentation and then open up for any questions or dialogue. Jumping right into it, we've got the 2014 rate study. And really what I want to do today is look at, from 2014, what we projected, what's actually occurred, and what are the underlying drivers of the financial performance of the utility. The timeline, so we're all on a common basis. Back in 2014, as was mentioned, was the original full rate study that looked at the revenue sufficiency plan, which is the trajectory of rate increases on an annual basis, as well as some rate structure changes. In 2016, and every year after the 2014 rate study, I was working behind the scenes with staff to update that plan, bring in the latest information and any other issues to ensure that the plan of increases would keep the utility sustainable. 2017, another financial sufficiency analysis, and then 2018, we began, updated the numbers, as well as created this addendum with documents of a lot of the trends that we've seen over the last few years. So the first thing I want to talk through is the revenues. What I have is a graphic up here for each of the last four fiscal years. In blue is where we thought we would be, given the study and the projections, the information we had in 2014. In black is the adopted MetCom budget. And in gray is what's actually occurred. The trend that we're seeing here is, as we look forward, especially as into 2016, when the updated rate structure was placed into service, which had a conservation tilt to it. It was inclining block, meant to encourage increasing price of water as you use more for residential customers. What we can see there is that the actual revenues have come in lower than we had projected, and also lower than your budget, but of note, your budget has come down to start meeting that in the last year. And so what I want to do is try to understand that and de-aggregate what are the drivers behind that that has caused that actual to come down. The first thing we looked at was the underlying growth of new EDUs or equivalent connections to the system. And what you can see here is in the 2014 study, we thought this would be roughly a 1% growth rate in each year of new connections coming onto the system. And so you can see that number coming across in each year. You can see the budgeted ones that were included in each of the budgets you passed on a go-forward basis, and then the actual. And so what the telling point is here is we had a lot up front, and then over time it's been a little bit of a lower connection rate than we expected in the study. And so that's contributed a little bit lower to annual revenues. Behavioral changes. So in my mind, when I look at this and I looked over the volumes, and we've got a little issue with the billing data as far as de-aggregating it to where we can see the clear definitive trend in volumes over time. But one of my biggest explanations for the decrease in the actual we've seen is the behavioral reaction to inclining block rates. So people receive the price messaging and modify their behavior or change their irrigation practices to conserve water, and that's likely the result of why we're seeing revenues come down a bit, as one would expect. Additionally, one of the things as part of the initial study was the billing of wastewater. And so before 2014, wastewater was a flat charge. You would pay a flat charge, and you would you could use as much or water as you wanted, and that charge would not increase. After 2014, it was linked to billed water volumes. And what that does is, for certain types of customers, particularly ones that irrigate a lot, can cause their bill to go up from a flat fee. What we did is, in 2016, though, right after the initial study, came in and put a wastewater cap in that would limit those billings per month. But I do believe that the combination of those things did have an impact on revenues, reducing revenues on a go-forward basis. And then the third one, bill modification practices. I know I saw there's a few items on the board later today for just bills that have come in, and we've had to modify those in a downward direction. So that's reduced revenue to a certain extent. On the sewer side of the equation, revenues, I've got, again, a very similar chart here where we're looking at the 2014 study, the METCOM budget, and the actuals. And what we can see is a very similar dynamic here. Once wastewater got linked up to water to a certain extent, any conservation that we see on that side as well will come through the rates in terms of lower revenue. Again, have done a similar table up front. The EDU growth, very similar. Water and sewer connections typically move together for the most part. And what we can see is whether it's the study or the budgeted, it's a little bit lower overall on the bottom there for the actuals, but the sewer connections have been a little bit higher. Wastewater billing cap did have an impairment to revenue of roughly $600,000. So when we categorized that and looked at how every account in your system used wastewater when it was billed based on water bills, and when we capped it, we did lose some revenue. So that really contributed on the sewer side to where we saw the revenue come down a bit.
I've got a
question
on that.
Sure.
Why did we cap it at 10,000? What's the rationale for that?
Yeah, exactly. So the rationale behind it is if we look at a typical residential household, there's two types of demands. One would be your indoor domestic uses, the laundry machine you can think of, and anything else you would use inside. And then you've got outdoor consumptive uses. And that particular type of use doesn't return to your wastewater system. And so when we bill it at the full water volume, for each month, there can be a situation that arises where if a user has a lot of outdoor consumption, we're charging them for all the return flows coming back to the wastewater system, but in actuality, it's not occurring. So what we did is we set a cap that was meant to essentially replicate the indoor domestic demands of a larger family in your service area. And then anything above that we've assumed is irrigation, a consumptive use that wouldn't return to the system. So it tries to provide some equity to irrigators that are using one single meter for their irrigation demands.
That is somewhat arbitrary, though, in that we do have meters for water consumption now.
What's that?
We have meters for water consumption now, but we kind of picked out an arbitrary number for sewer.
So if you have a single meter, and this is just applied to a single meter that goes to a household, they'll have the two types of demands I just described. And what we did is we used the census data for how many people are typically in a household, as well as EPA data that suggests what the typical indoor residential requirements are. And so those numbers were used in combination to try to estimate what those indoor demands would look like.
Mm-hmm. Your block, are they water EDUs or sewer EDUs?
These are sewer up on the board right now, sir.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Sewer in the short term.
Does a $10,000, 10,000 gallon cap apply to all units?
It applies to all
townhouses,
single family residential with a single meter serving them. So if you have a sub meter or you have a second irrigation meter, that doesn't apply to you because we're able to clearly differentiate.
I understand that, but does this apply to like townhouses, condos?
Don't believe so, sir. No.
Tell me, isn't sewer predicated on the amount of water that you use?
It is.
So mm-hmm. You don't have a way of metering return for waste?
No, there is such a thing as a sewer meter, but it's a pretty hard thing to keep up.
Well,
so we typically don't have it, yes.
My point is like you say, you're figuring a large family home, and
yes,
you're trying to get to equity. I think equity is a good thing.
Absolutely.
And the bottom line, though, is you're using that 10,000 for a large family, and like Randy just said, I'm sure a townhouse doesn't use that much. So.
Mm-hmm.
As we've gone towards more equity, I'm not sure we've gone all the way. But here's my other question.
Mm-hmm.
Your actual EDUs up there, go back to 14. What was the trend before that? Not that I'm hoping you know off the top of your head. Was it always as high as what those budgeteds were, those 233s? Those budgeteds always seem to be very much higher than actual, except for 2018, of course.
Yeah, don't have it right off the top of my head. What you're referring to as the budget in the past? Or?
Well, my point is that if 13, 12, 11, 10, we're all showing the same trending, which is lower than budgeted, lower, would that factor into your study?
Yeah, I mean, it definitely would. And I think the trend, as we can see here, though, is going on a forward basis, especially 18. You know, we've started to converge that budget down to the actual levels. And as we see that data come in, we've tried to continue to make those adjustments so that on a go-forward basis, we're not overestimating.
So with just one more comment.
Yes, sir.
So in effect, the larger users are being subsidized by the rest of the property owners.
The larger.
The rest of our customers. So, and we do have a mechanism for making it equal, you know, based on your usage. I'm just not sure we're not.
And we're still talking about the wastewater cap?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. For instance, a long time ago in Fairfax County, I was paying the water bills. And it was, the sewer was based on the 5 months of winter usage for the whole year. And that seemed to take care of the whole problem.
Yeah.
But we don't do that here. We have an arbitrary, in my mind, an arbitrary 10,000 gallons cap.
So you're exactly right in the sense that, you know, we're trying to get to equity. There are a couple different ways to get there. So you mentioned winter averaging. So communities will try to get to this idea of equity and capturing the indoor domestic, the proper sewer flows, by either winter averaging, which is essentially looking at your months that you don't have irrigation and trying to understand what your water usage trends are there, assuming that's all indoor usage. The other way that they will do it is force people to put in that second meter and say, you cannot irrigate through a single meter, you need to put in a second meter so we know exactly how much is on the lawn. And then the third way is what you currently have in place, which would be a cap sized using some assumptions with regards to indoor usage. So if you look across the country, you'll see all three of those in different frequencies. In different areas, some are much more popular. Over in the East Coast here, we do see the combination of either a cap or a winter average. You could do it either way and arrive at a similar level of equity.
You just brought up something like an additional meter. Mm-hmm. I know an entire township that if you have irrigation and the outside faucets on a separate meter.
Absolutely.
And it's been seen that expensive. If you were to start forcing that on people as they develop and build, would that bring the revenue back into better focus by doing that?
So I do believe we provide the option for an irrigation and a mm-hmm. second meter. So well, that option does exist to a high user who feels like the 10,000 gallon cap doesn't apply accurately to them.
Well, $10,000 cap would be nice for anybody who's irrigating or not irrigating, really, when right. you think about it. But if they're using more than that, say another 10,000 gallons is being thrown on the grass and washing or whatever, meter might be an option. Mm-hmm. I know an entire township that if you put an irrigation system, you have to have another meter.
Yeah.
It's tapped off of them.
And that's the industry trend we see out there.
It's a separate meter for any kind of outdoor usage, so it's not going into the sewer system. You know that.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they'll be billed for that additional water.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Perfect. So as I mentioned, the two items driving wastewater revenues were the cap that was put into place, which reduced the annual level of revenues by about $600,000, and as well as the growth. Additionally, you know, we attached on a go-forward basis, as I mentioned, wastewater billings to build water volumes. It was a flat fee before, so that also introduced a figure into the revenues on a go-forward basis. As we saw some water consumption, likely would flow through to the sewer side as well. So expense trends, we've seen on the revenue side, it's down a little bit lower. On the expense trend, I've got the 2014 study in yellow, in black, the MetCom budget, and then the actuals in gray. And what we can see here is with the projections in 2014 were very close to the actual levels of expenditures. And in black is the budget going up. So what we're seeing here, so I looked at the trends over a multi-year period when we did the study in 2014, and also in the time in between that. What we see is there was a variance between the budgeted amount of expenditures and the execution, how much you're actually spending in each given year. The projections that we generated in 14 and on a go-forward basis include the idea that you're not executing your budget at 100%. The trends historically were below 90%, 85 to 90, right in that range on a go-forward basis. I think the last year we just got the data was right over 90%, so about 92% in the last year, the 2018 unaudited. So that's come up a little bit. That's one of the trends that's allowed us, even with lower revenues, to be sustainable because the expenses haven't come in at the fully budgeted level in each year. And so The other item that would be underneath there is the underlying inflation trends. And so there's budget execution, and then there's the inflation trends, which is the idea that over time your expenses just get more expensive, like anything else that you would buy normally. What you can see here is we had projected in the study about 4.5% inflation. That's roughly come in line, actually, with what we've seen in the actual. The underlying inflation is still coming through the expenses. We see that in the line item details, as well as in the total budget. It's the execution that's allowed us to get to a point where we're sustainable, given that our revenues have been a little bit lower. And you can see here, brought up in the table here, the execution percentages of the O&M budget for 16, 17, and then unaudited 18 here.
So that's a question. The inflation rate is different than the normal published inflation rate of the country.
Yes, absolutely. You got one step ahead of me, I'll be right there. So you're absolutely right.
Could you, for the audience's sake, define how you determine inflation?
So absolutely. So inflation in these terms is just looking at the budget from year to year and trying to understand the overall change in that budget from year to year.
So you're reflecting overall cost in as well.
Overall cost increase, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so key findings from just the analysis of top line revenue and expenditures, the wastewater billing cap did reduce wastewater revenue. We did have some lower customer growth, especially if we look on the water side, which contributed to some lower revenue. Additionally, the largest contributor, I believe, and that's one thing that, you know, as we continue to get better and better billing data, we want to understand is the underlying behavior of customers as to how they've responded to the inclining block rates and some of the conservation that I believe is driving a lot of the revenue variance we see on the water side of the equation. Utility bill reduction practices. There definitely have been some utility bill reductions that have factored. It's not huge by any means. It's just more of something to mention there that's come up recently in front of the commission. And then on the expenses, as I mentioned, budget execution trends have been the largest component of allowing us to be sustainable here as we go forward, with our expenditures coming in below the budgeted levels. And then moderate underlying inflation trends. So your inflation trends are right in line with what we see in the industry, and I'll bring up a chart here in a second to talk that through. The next component, so switching gears, looked at what's happened. Now we want to understand if we were to update all the data on a go-forward basis, what is the projection for rate? For rates. What I've done is put in your 2018 budget into our financial forecasting model. This model looks out 10 years. Assumes cost inflation of your 2018 budget on a go-forward basis. We've assumed as well that you have budget execution in there, so your budget's not going to be fully executed in each and every year, but rather for things like personal services, you've got vacancies and attrition. On O&M, we've assumed an 80% spend level consistent with historical trends. And then we've assumed that 1% growth level in there as well. And so we talked about that a little bit. Does appear, you know, as we bounce back, that that's relatively in alignment on a go-forward basis with our expectations. But again, growth in any given year can be much higher, much less, depending on how it actually unfolds. And what we're seeing, the good news here is, we think the level of annual rate increases can come down. And I'm going to give you a couple options to be able to do that. But the 3.75 and the 3.0 that we've had with sewer and water, respectively, for the last few years, has put us in a pretty good financial position. And as we project out, one of the things we're going to want to do is manage the reserves that we have on hand. We don't want to grow reserves too high. We want to manage also the cash in and cash out to make sure that we're sustainable long term, that your cash in and cash out are structurally balanced. I've gone ahead and run a scenario here. One of the baselines I get asked to do a lot is to say, well, what happens if we just don't have any rate increases? If we just do zero? This is the plan with zero rate increases, and it works just like your personal bank account. Here is the operating fund balance. Here's the cash in and cash out. If we don't keep in alignment with the underlying inflation, the cash out gets above our cash in, and your bank account will start to dwindle. And what we can see is by the mid-20s, 2025, we're below our defined policy target. And we continue to head down on a downward path. And that would be okay for a few years, but what happens is that rate pressure builds underneath. And so to fix that problem, even if we just had a few years with zero rate increases, would cause us to go into the double digits in 1 year, a scenario where we'd have to raise rates immediately to get this blue line to bend up to the cash out line. And so that's the scenario with no rate increases. These are the additional options I've provided, so option 1, 2, and 3. It's the idea of, and they're labeled from less conservative to more conservative. So option 1 would say, we recognize the fact that we can lower rate increases. We go to a much lower level of inflationary increases right away, to 1.5 to 2.0 here on water and sewer, respectively. That is a sustainable plan. Likely, though, in the out years, you'd have to do a little bit higher. So that's trying to manage the reserve policies, recognizing the executional trends that we're seeing. As we go down into option 2, we're going to take that a little bit slower in the path to bend those annual increases down. And then option 3 is a reduction of 5% per year in the rate, which is the slowest drop down to inflationary levels over time. And so, all three of these options are on the table and sustainable. I think, though, given some of the underlying uncertainty with regards to the billing data and the EDU growth, some of these, the middle option, option 3, are probably some of the ones that would make a lot of sense for your system. What do they look like, though, on a go-forward basis? What I have up here is just the net income over time. So one of the things that I'm trying to do is manage that net income when I look out and forecast the system so we don't put too much money in the bank over time. We want to make sure that we're structurally sound. And what you can see is these over time slowly bend down that net income to where we try to get income and expenses right on top of each other.
Excuse me, option 4, just help me out. I see 1, 2, 3. That's the option where we don't do anything.
So option 3. Yeah, so this was a labeling, and I apologize for that right there. So in the future option, I've termed option 1, that's option 0, where I just showed you, which was no rate increase, option 1. So just a labeling dynamic right there. But what this goes back to is option 1, 2, 3, option 1, 2, 3.
Oh, okay. Next slide.
Key considerations, EDU growth, customer behavior, and operational execution, things I've talked about. These are the key underlying assumptions that as we forecast out would impact the overall financial performance of the utility. We mentioned inflation. What does inflation look like? Industry trends. What I've shown up here is the one we all talk about, just the consumer price index. It's the one we hear about in the news when the Bureau of Labor and Statistics tells us what the underlying level of inflation is. This typically right now is hovering right around 2% right in that range, and that represents the basket of goods that a typical consumer would buy. Utilities are different. The basket of goods that a utility buys are significantly a lot more concrete, a lot more steel, a lot more other things that don't necessarily get reflected in this number. And so what else is out there is, I've talked to the guys over at the Bureau of Labor and Statistics, one of their sub-indices is essentially a measure of rate increases for utilities across the country. So they take a look at water and sewer, they hold the consumption flat, and they measure that change over time. And what we see is for the last 30 years, that's been between about 5 to 6%. And I put up here the last 10 years, which have been over 5, trending down in the last few years here. But point is significantly higher above the CPI that we're all familiar with. Graphed in here on the blue line, a look at the overall inflation that an average Metcom customer has seen the last few years. And what you can see there is you're essentially coming right near the industry in the long term, especially as we get in the last few years or right under that. And so you've been essentially right in or below industry levels of inflation.
So that's the question I've got on that chart. So that, for instance, in year 2008, it went up like 18%. Mm-hmm. In 2009, that 18% stayed there,
mm-hmm.
But it stayed, the curve was flat.
Exactly.
Okay. And
Okay.
It wasn't any tremendous drop or anything.
No, not at all. Just annual level of change. Right. Absolutely. And trying to understand how you've compared with industry trends. Mm-hmm. So conclusions and recommendations, continue to manage the utility in a proactive manner. And so, one of the things that's been great is we've been looking at, and staff's been looking at in the background and understanding how these changes affect the utility, and continue to look at that projection of these annual increases to ensure that we're sustainable on a go-forward basis. Ensure the accuracy of bill volume. So as I mentioned, and it keeps coming up, I know it's in the addendum a few times, but the understanding of customer behavior is critical to our assumptions on a go-forward basis, and especially understanding how the inclining block rates affected consumption within the service area. Review bill adjustment policy at the board level. Generally, we see that in most communities we go to a much more of an administrative level, but just want to ensure that is brought up. And then review the inflation factor on the budget on a go-forward basis for 2020. As I noticed on the chart with the budgets over the last few years, the budget has grown quite a bit as compared to the actual underlying expenditures. And so that's one thing we want to look at to make sure that budget fully reflects where we think we're going to be spending at. And then closely review realized EDU growth. We want to understand and watch how that growth comes onto the system, how it impacts our financial future. And then consider an initial $250,000 residential connection pilot program. And then consider a 50% capital deferral program to help incentivize development within the community.
Could you give me a little more detail, please, on number six?
Yeah, absolutely. And I have to defer to staff a little bit on those programs, but internally, those have been some programs that staff has looked at to consider putting some money aside out of the general fund in order to help residents connect. George, I don't know if you have some additional detail we can provide.
Yeah, our board has discussed the possibility based on Chapter 113. The legislation that was just approved last year is trying to incentivize some connections as opposed to require, because we don't have a mandated connection policy. So the thought is to provide upwards of $25,000 per household to help incentivize, in addition to bay restoration funds for failing systems, to try to incentivize people to connect to our system, whether it be water or sewer. We would offer a 5% payback at a much lower interest rate, perhaps, than they could get commercially.
To be clear, it's a loan program.
Right. It's not a grant program.
It's predicated on 5% capital.
With a low interest rate.
Low interest rate, that's right.
What's interest rate predicated on?
Our internal cost of capital, Netcom's cost of capital, a rough average.
3 to 4%.
So between 3 and 4.
Right. So we borrow money at that rate. We figured we might as well loan it to our customers at roughly that rate as well, minus the administrative burden of initiating a loan, doing, executing the actual program. So
same thing on the 50% number seven, it's essentially a loan.
Well, the 50% is a little different. Your capital contribution charges are paid up front at the time of application, and we changed the law, Chapter 113, to allow us to consider the potential for commercial customers or developers to pay 50% up front, and then the balance of the 50% at the time of UNO. So it allows them to utilize cash up front for other things other than just paying their application fee.
So we
can
float that cost for a little bit longer.
Okay.
In the end,
Look, it seems like your major concern here is that you did this rate change, and I'm not sure if you're the guy behind it, Mr. Stevens, but that indicated, well, that resulted in lower revenues than projected. Now, you're saying that $600,000 loss due to cap on wastewater was part of it. Second part was people were more conservative because they said, like, hey, look, it's getting too high. So what's your answer to it? When you talk about modest rate increases, what's that mean to them?
So, to me, that means matching the consumer price index for inflation, right? So I wouldn't want to see
yours or the one that DC puts out.
The one that DC puts out, the actual consumer price inflation. But we need to be realistic about what a utility is required to do, right? If our cost of chemicals and electricity and everything else is rising at a different rate than what the consumer price index is rising at, we have to behave accordingly. Right.
So that's why your inflation is higher than what we're seeing nationally, what I'm seeing on the.
I want
to. Utilities in general.
Absolutely.
Utilities in general.
Are higher.
Absolutely.
And the other factor, Commissioner Hewitt, would be the projection of EDUs. The EDU projections were much higher than reality. And 2 years ago, we lowered our EDUs by over 60. We lowered them another 30, I think, on the sewer side this past year. so that we can get our revenues much more in line with our expenditures and our realization of revenues more in line with expectations.
Well, it looks like 18 you had sewer in line with production.
We got very close, very close.
The water's still the...
Still significantly closer, and our utilization on our operating budget was up in over 92%, which is the first time that's happened in many, many years.
It's also been difficult to predict EDUs, but we've now have a very stable cost of an EDU, and I think that will increase predictability through time for developers as well as a homeowner, landowner who just wants to build and connect to water and sewer, right? It's not fluctuating wildly now. We've kept very stable over the last 3 years.
I would commend you on that. Because I would say to you 2 years ago, I remember seeing numbers of $40,000 to hook up. And I was thinking, man, that's going to put a real damper on economic development. But this 17, 18, even though some people still say it's too high, it's been smoothed out, if that's the term.
I do think, Mr. Chairman, our commissioners, that whole perspective of looking at how we can help residential customers come online, which increases the EDUs, which is the revenue generated for us. So I think, you know, it's going to be an experiment for us, but I think we're pretty confident, aren't we, not, Mr. Chairman, that we'll be able to make some inroads there. And in fact, we've already done in some subdivisions, especially people have failing systems and all those kind of things. And so George and his team are trying to put some stuff in place where people can take advantage of that. And it's kind of like from the county side, when I was doing roads in Spring Valley years ago, you know, we went to the county and we got the money, tax bill, paid for it. And so I think that's a real plus from the Chapter 113 modification that's going to help us grow our EDUs.
And we're one of the few jurisdictions that don't have mandatory connections. I mean, you'll see later when we talk about the GIS effort, over 1,100 potential customers on the water and sewer side combined that are within 200 feet of one of our systems. If you go to 1,000 feet, which isn't necessarily that far away, that number jumps to over 3,000, almost 4,000. There are a lot of customers extremely close to our facilities, but without requiring and making that a mandate, we can only go by...
But George, we've heard from the public on that requirement for hookup.
Absolutely.
And I think what we've heard is my system's working fine, I don't want to have to be forced to.
Absolutely.
That's correct.
But yeah, we're on board with that. Chapter 113 is consistent. I think the delegation is consistent, but that is the fifth challenge we didn't talk about to the predictability of revenue on the revenue side. There's a lot of potential customers, but that's a lot of customers we don't have when you look at the small number of EDUs we see each year.
I think I'd also like to laud the staff a little bit. I mean, it's identified as a strange characteristic of our budget, right? But I think our staff has worked very, very hard to keep actuals as low as possible. So although it could have been as bad as budgeted and predicted, I'd like to commend all of the MetCom folks for working very, very hard to stay within what is best operational efficiency. They're not just trying to stay under budget, they're trying to do the best, most efficient operation they possibly can. So that's helped us maintain stability in the face of rising electric rates, rising chemical costs, bringing Monty Taylor online. There's been a lot of things that you should have seen in a significant expense bump that we've been able to control. So now we're looking at the other line. We're looking at top line. We've got to grow the number of customers. That's the bottom line. Right? Without the ability to spread that fixed cost amongst more people.
Again, I would say as long as it's incentivized, right, it looks like you're doing that, versus forced, which I don't think people like.
Yeah. We just like to make it as easy as possible for folks to get connected if they need to, or if they want to.
And we did debate a grant program, even for the lower income, but I think where we're headed at the moment, we haven't finalized our plan, was to extend that term of payback as opposed to provide a grant. So instead of a 5-year payback, make it 10 to make it more affordable for the lower income. Because our customers are going to look at us giving away money, and I don't know that that's going to be looked on, you know, very graciously. So the concept would be to make sure it's no cost and that we do get the money returned to get the support from the rest of our customer base, because it's their money we're using to offer these loans.
At the end of the day, this $250,000 pilot program on an annual basis, it only allows us to provide about 10 $25,000 loans,
which is very much.
So even if we bump by 10 to our EDU numbers of roughly 110, 120 per year, that's a nice 10% increase in the number of EDUs, assuming that it's completely accretive, but it's not 50%, it's not 100% growth, right? So that's a good start.
That's a good start.
Well, we're also trying to make it sustainable. So you have to get paid back fast enough to make the program self-sustaining. So we don't necessarily want to give away 10 that first year. We can sustain between 3 to 5 per year. And that's just not a lot.
Well, the 250 is probably arbitrary, I would assume. And if you had demand, you could up the 250.
We can go back to the reserve and up the 250. That's why this is a pilot.
Right. I mean, the key is get more customers.
Absolutely.
I think by this time next year, or at least certainly the year after, we will have some good numbers to propose to you guys and say, you know, whether it's 250 or 500 or 750 or whatever the number turns out to be, we'll go from there. I think we're on the right track to help the customers who want to go onto the system, and that helps that come as well, and the county as well.
Mr. Fairfax, I'd say we're getting less calls, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, we're getting less emails and calls, that's for sure. That's for sure.
But there is the opportunity, and the commissioners should be aware that there's an opportunity for the county commissioners to help fund this project. We wanted to expand the scope of this loan program. Again, it's not a grant program. This money is coming back to the taxpayers and ratepayers of the Metropolitan Commission of St. Mary's County. That is something that we can do. So if we find that there is extreme demand here, we may knock on your door and say, would you be willing to help us fund it? Our budget is much smaller than yours.
No, it's pretty close. Don't say it's smaller, it's pretty close. Okay, do we have any more questions, Mr. Steve?
Yeah, I guess something I've been kind of beating on a little bit. The way I'm looking at our current rates, the 10,000 is an artificial cap that people use more than that, legitimately use more than that, but it's capped at 10,000. Our water rates are 4 times higher for those using over 20,000 gallons as opposed to under 5,000 gallons. So we're subsidizing the high users in sewerage, and the high users in water are subsidizing the lower users, okay? And the numbers are fairly significant. In my mind, we've got meters, we've got all the tools, we've got computers, we've got all the tools that we need to go to the winter, summer type model. And that's, to me, that's much more equitable to the customer. And I know it's a big change in our billing operations, but the tools are there, and I think sooner or later we have to get there.
It's definitely a choice for consideration. The only thing I'll give you just a thought. As with winter averaging, you know, there are other things that can come into play there as well. That each one has, I think, drawbacks and positives. So the dynamic that we see sometimes with winter averaging is that if there's occupancy changes throughout the year, if people have vacation homes or leave, sometimes those dynamics can play in and really hurt those numbers when you try to use that on an annual basis as the threshold to then charge sewer. So just consider that there are drawbacks and pluses to each of those different rate structures.
We're also, Commissioner Thompson, we're gathering, since 2014, it's been a while, we're gathering the four winter month data to see what the actual numbers are compared to the 10,000 gallon cap. And we're going to bring that back to the board in response to your comments left the last meeting.
It's also on a national level. It's good to see, in my mind, that conservation in our rate pricing model actually generated conservation.
Good.
I mean, we have a good aquifer underneath St. Mary's County, but I mean, it still doesn't mean that we should just have hoses in the sewer.
True.
So I think that we need to maintain some sort of structure that incentivizes efficient use of our natural resources.
Yes. Any other questions to Mr. Stevens here?
I would say, in addition to John's comments, even the lower rate payers, that the people that pay the low rates, they're conserving as well, because you want to meet a bill now.
Sure.
So that's true. Okay. Not just a high.
Perfect.
Thank you so much.
Your
presentation, very good. Next we have the St. Clement Shore Project Updates. Mr. George Erickson, Executive Director.
Morning, Commissioner.
Morning.
Congratulations to everybody, I guess, right?
Yeah, that's true.
This will be a real quick presentation. In your packages is a memorandum to you all dated, I think it's the 26th of October. Mm-hmm. For many years, you know, St. Clement Shores has been an issue, both on the St. Mary's County Commissioner side and the Metropolitan Commission side. We have a lot of folks down there with failing systems or near failing systems who haven't been able to connect. The history behind it is there are 29 properties that have EDUs that aren't connected, and then 5 additional properties that have health department designation as being critical. The issue that we've had is we haven't had the capacity of the plant, nor has the funding been available to allow these folks to hook up. So I think on October 10th, I sent around an email to our board. That's included in your packages today, as well as a map of those affected properties. Interestingly enough, the 29, I keep saying 29, but I think 3 or 4 have since then given up their EDUs. I'm sure today they're sorry that they did, but they gave up hope, I guess, down in St. Clement Shores. So you've got 3 or 4 of those 29 properties that actually have given up their EDUs through land use and growth management into the free pool of EDUs, which is a shame, really. So what we have now, last October, we began a pilot project with some new technology down at St. Clement Shores to try to improve our treatment and our capacity. We went to the county commissioners, I think it was last January, so I want to thank the board. We did a budget amendment through our board and through the county commissioner board, not this past January, but January 2017, to kick this off. I think it was about $906,000. What has happened since that time is we've completed work on what we call our rapid infiltration basins. We've completed our pilot project, it's called BioWeb, on our treatment plant facility. We started that in December. It was only supposed to be a 4-month pilot, but we weren't happy with the results, so we asked the state if we could extend that through August, which they graciously said sure. And what we have in your packages are 3 or 4 different correspondences that are really great news to the folks down there. The first one is an old one from last July that says the 5 failing systems can hook up. Don't worry about capacity, don't worry about treatment level, they can hook up today. We thought that was great news. Problem is, it costs a lot of money to hook up. And our plant is not permitted for what's called BNR treatment levels. And unfortunately, our permit is 13 milligrams per liter for total nitrogen. To get special funding through the health department, you actually need to be treating at an 8 milligram per liter level. So we did this pilot project, we saw numbers in the tens, we saw the numbers higher than 18, we saw 13. Through the winter months it was awful, we had a lot of rain. We wanted consistent data that we could rely on. We started seeing numbers that were 2, 3, 4, and 5. We changed our permit, there's a permit request in your books today. We wanted to get our permit to not be on a monthly basis, on an annual basis, but we wanted to have enough data to know that when we did that average, we would still hit the 8 target. Mike Sullivan, I'd like to thank him. He worked with MDE as well on our staff, and they were able to recalculate how we calculate our total nitrogen removal. And we are comfortable with being able to get to the 8 milligram per liter. This is a risk that we are taking to some degree, but we think it's a calculated risk, but a risk I think that will show great rewards. And we have an email from MDE just recently, I think it was dated October 10th, that said, you know what, we're going to make these properties down here in St. Clement Shores eligible for Bay Restoration Funds, which is a big deal
yes.
for those folks down there.
Yes,
now, before we get excited, there's still a process they have to go through. Typically, these funds are only given to folks in the priority funding area. St. Clement Shores, you got to read the fine print, St. Clement Shores is not in the priority funding area. However, MDE is already in the process of working out what's called a waiver. It's just a waiver. They've done it in other communities before. It's not a big deal, but there's a public hearing process they have to go through. So they're going through that process at this time, and they're also modifying our permit at this time as well. So that's a real brief synopsis of where we are today. And I want to commend everybody that's worked on it. It's hard to know who to give credit to. County commissioners, you approved the budget amendment. Our staff are working really well. MDE, who actually dug down and is helping us calculate our total nitrogen removal differently than would normally be done. And we want to send our appreciation to them as well. And Daryl Calvano, he's not here today. He's done a great job. He's been an advocate of this. He's the guy with the money, and they can't spend it. The reason they can't spend it is there's a lot of requirements placed on these funds.
and we are probably, this is probably the first major project that's helped a significant number of folks in the community in a while, at least for St. Mary's County. So,
George, I want to commend you on this one. This is one that 4 years ago, when I got elected, people said, D, you cannot get this done. This is too hard. And Randy and I went up and met with MDE, went to Kent Island. They came here. And I think the most significant thing, and I hate to be political here, but Hogan's people came here. Lynn Buell, his number two, and said, the governor wants to say yes. And we found a way to get the Chadwicks hooked up, the Howells hooked up, and using Bay Restoration funding. So excuse me. Yay!
Well, if you could.
It's a victory. If now, here's the other thing I want to bring up to you, George.
I knew that was coming.
Have looked at a lot of these 29 EDUs. And several people, when I was on the road, I'll call it, I went in that neighborhood, and many people there have multiple EDUs. There was one woman who has four EDUs for her single home. Now, where I'm going with this, and I'm not sure how you're going to work on it, but her point was, she only needs one. She's got four, and she doesn't believe they're costing her that much. I don't know what they're costing her. But she thinks the other three are worth something to her, so she doesn't want to turn them back in. So where I'm going with this is, we may want to consider like a TDR program for EDUs.
Well, I've suggested that before. That'd be a county initiative. Seems to me that the TDR program works. Seems like the EDU program would be similar.
Could work.
The way it works now, it goes into a pool, and it's assigned to those who need it most. So it goes immediately to failing systems. I think the way TDR program works is sort of a commercially bid, and the highest bidder gets the TDRs. Right. This is a little bit different, but certainly.
But TDRs are like under 5,000. What this woman did tell me, I said, well, look, why don't you put four homes? She said the lots are only 20 feet wide. She has an 80 foot wide lot with her one home on it, but having 20 foot wide lots. And another person out there turned his in because he said he didn't want to pay for it because he couldn't build anything on it with today's building rights. So to have those 29 out there and reserving capacity for them, may need us to do a little bit of work.
Oh, sure. I think it's a worthwhile endeavor. I really do. You can have smaller residential homes that are quasi-commercial. They need one more EDU. Person down the street has four. They only need one. Why can't that be passed on to someone who needs them? I think it's a great idea.
You got four more years of this board of commissioners, so maybe it's time to work on.
That's for you to propose and for us to.
You're liable to see.
That'd be perfect. We'd be happy to help you.
You need us to propose?
Yes, sir.
Get started.
All right. And one other item, we're talking about legislation. I think we've talked to Secretary Buell as well. There's no law against this. What I think would be really beneficial to a lot of folks in St. Mary's County is if we could achieve total nitrogen of 8 milligrams per liter, you get 100% funding. If you hit 10, maybe 80.
What are you hitting on a yearly average with this new system you got? Are you down as low as 8?
We haven't had an entire year.
Oh, you haven't had a year.
We're comfortable that with our averages that we'll meet.
Have you gone through a winter with this system?
We did, and that's why we extended the pilot. We got a lot of rain and a pretty cool winter.
So a lot of rain.
So the key there, we used to have a permit that was based on a per month basis.
Right.
So that's being changed to annual. Now we're much more comfortable saying we can live through the winter months because we're overperforming in the summer and fall and spring.
So you probably meet this 8%.
Oh, we're definitely excited about meeting that percentage. Yeah. And from what we understand, if we achieve this year and folks are eligible for Bay Restoration funding and we underachieve, we may get penalized the next year, but the individuals who benefited from that achievement don't have to pay it back. That's actually really important to know.
Sounds good, George.
And that's the brief, just a brief overview. As always, if the county commissioners have questions, just call them.
One thing, down in St. Columbus, George, and to Mike's point, the person who has four EDUs, there's people who have called me, and the only way they can use those EDUs is if they have it on that one piece of property where the land is contiguous.
Right.
They can't move that to like another lot.
It goes with the property.
It goes with the property. So there's people who have said, you know, I got this lot down there, a nice lot. Can I move my EDU to that lot? But there's a lot of people who do have. I know one lady has right before the old Don Soubrette. She has a nice lot.
she wants an EDU for that lot, but she can't build, she don't have EDU now, but she'd like to purchase EDU.
That's not a bad idea either. I mean, I don't think it's a bad idea to start talking about this and getting some ideas together.
But the way we understand the program, once you deallocate your EDU, it goes into a general pool.
Well, so we need to look at that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe the EDU, like we said, solid.
Yeah, well, but if you have people been, like this lady out there, been paying for these three that she did, yeah, it wouldn't be, I mean, maybe she could sell it, would be fair to her. But if she had to deallocate and just put it back into
the pool doesn't get, so like I said, treat it as a sale, like a TDR. Yeah.
But you want to keep what they were trying to avoid was taking that and putting it down on a waterfront lot that didn't perk, and then they'd use it down there, and then, you know, all of a sudden you got a lot that's worth a lot of money.
Well, but I think what you're going to run into, at least when I was canvassing those people down in St. Clement Shores, is once the neighbors started finding out that the Chadwicks may be able to get it, they said, look, we don't want to report ourselves, but we have the same issue when the groundwater's high, it's really wet, our toilet goes down very slow. Mm-hmm. So I think you're going to find people who are failing once they figure this out and will want to come and be your customers. The key is going to be this 100% of a high percentage rate of helping them connect. So I think you're going to find a lot. That's why I think if you were able to free up this other 29 somehow, or at least if people aren't going to use them because they're 20-foot wide lots.
Right. Well, I think we're interested in working with the county and land use and growth management on exactly how that would work.
Right.
Sort it out over the next year.
Yeah, an EDU TDR program, I think, is a big win for everybody.
Or even being able to move them too, that's not a bad
one. On the EDUs, since those, there were only five people that gave up their EDU.
No, sir. There are five failing systems. Out of the 29, there are three or four that I believe relinquished their EDU. Okay. Out of the 29.
See, if maybe there should be some flexibility there because they gave up on their EDUs because of us, not necessarily because of them. So is there any way we could have them back pay, restore?
Well, we can't do anything. We don't control the program, and I'm just guessing that they gave up.
Yeah.
There may be an affordability issue, you know, that we don't know about. You know, waterfront lots, they just can't afford it anymore. They inherited it from their parents, and they just don't want to build down there. They don't want to live there, or the family's just not interested in owning the property. So that's just me surmising that they gave them up, and I believe it's a shame that they did, nonetheless.
All right,
thank you.
Thank you, George. Next, we have a acceptance of bond amount for MedCom Treasurer, Chapter 113-1.E. Can you all read the proposal?
Yeah, I guess he wants to get some. George, is your treasurer?
Yep.
How's it been going?
Good.
Any discussion on that, or is this very much?
Mr. President, I move to approve the bond amount given to the State of Maryland in the amount of $250,000 for the appointed treasurer of the St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission in accordance with Chapter 113-1.E of the Code of St. Mary's County.
Second.
Our first and second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it. President, legislation for Chapter 113 text amendment. Mr. Erickson again. With Mr. Beaver.
And just to start, thanks again to our board and the county commissioners for entertaining that task force last year. Everybody thought it was not going to be successful. Ended up being very successful, and I think we've made a lot of salient changes. At our joint meeting back in May, I think it was May 23rd, we discussed the next round of changes. And what we agreed to do this year, I think on both boards, was to do a lot of administrative cleanup. The document hasn't been rewritten in years. It has no definition section. The county commissioners are called four to five different things. Our board, it's either the Metropolitan Commission, the Metcom board, the commissioners. It's a little bit confusing. So we are working with the delegation and their bill writing team just to clean the document up. And instead of it being a proposal from the county commissioners and a proposal from the Metcom board and the joint letter and then going to the bill writers and then talking to the delegation, what's happened this year is the bill writers are talking to us, and they're asking for our suggestions on changes. They can do it on their own, but we have a quick list here that we provided you, as well as our board, of items that we noticed when we read through the document. And we sent this up to the bill writing team, and Mr. Beaver has been actually in direct contact with them on a weekly basis to check progress. So I think how it's going to work this year is both boards will see the bill, and they'll ask us what we think, and then we'll send a letter up. It's a little bit unusual, but it shows that we're working together. A lot of times, one board will send a request up, and another board won't know about it, or a delegation will propose things that neither board knows anything about. And I think this is actually working out really well over the past 2 years. We get along really well with the folks up the road, and I think this will be another example of a successful effort this year again.
Excellent. Again, I think it's just a matter of having dealt with this piece of legislation for quite a lot, this piece of statute for quite a long time, you realize that it's not very user-friendly, and I think that's one of the biggest points that we've been working with the bill writing team on, is to make it more user-friendly, to make the terminology consistent throughout the statute, to help give you subheadings and points to be able to go through. When you read through 113, you'll see there are paragraphs that go on for 2 pages, right? Just run-on sentence after run-on sentence, breaking those down to make it easier when you're going in to try to find an answer to a question that you have. It'll be a lot easier to do that. That's one of the big
things. Let me ask you my question was.
Sure.
Impact fees, should a reference be added as a possible source of revenue funding? Are you looking for some kind of revenues out of the impact fees?
Well, I think that was referring to the change in the provision with regard to impact fees from the county and whether that was going to be incorporated in here into 113 or not.
But, I mean, I guess you know that's all reserved for schools, whether it's parks and parks, you want to get some.
Well, the resolution was specific to water and sewer, and it just recognizes, the law needs to recognize things before it can actually use them, right? The law does not recognize impact fees as a potential revenue source, and the resolution or ordinance that the board passed actually has water and sewer projects as an eligible cost. We don't expect in our budgeting to see any of that money from the county commissioners, but if we did, that certainly is a potential, the way your ordinance is written.
Overall strategy of flexibility. A little bit of room to move. We're not making a funding request through the impact fees.
All right.
But we're not specifically precluding that impact fee money could never be used to fund something at MedCom.
Well, I guess my initial reaction is against it because, you know, you guys are quasi-independent board. All we do is appoint your members and approve your debt. You can do whatever you want with your rates, whatever you guys do here. So, you know, as far as getting in on the impact fee,
I think we're just trying to recognize a legal ordinance that had passed, and it's a potential source, whether it's a viable one or not.
I was trying to recognize what that meant to somebody who wants to build a house.
Simply consistency between 113 and the county's regulations.
Again, I would still say someone who has water, sewer versus well, septic, you know, those people shouldn't be paying.
Oh, yeah. Sure. No, and that, again, that's within the purview of the county under your regulation.
And maybe not necessarily the most significant, but in one of the sections, I think it's 113.30, the MDE wrote a response to the delegation as well as legislation last year. And I think it was Mr. Sparling's language that we inserted into the text. And what the state pointed out to us is the process of which the capital improvement plan is approved actually goes through the Planning Commission. And what we tried to do is streamline the insertion of the capital budget into the Comprehensive Water and Sewer Plan. Remember we did that? We said we shouldn't have 3 hearings. We already have 5 on the capital budget. Once the capital budget's approved, it ought to be able to just be rolled into the Comprehensive Water and Sewer Plan. Well, MDE pointed out that action can't preclude the approval of the Planning Commission by law. Well, we all know that. So one of the suggestions this year is to make sure we address MDE's comments, even though the legislation passed last year, to just say after the Planning Commission approves it, it goes to the board, and then it gets inserted automatically. It's just a formality, but it makes Chapter 113 consistent with all other law, which specifically requires the Planning Commission to be an integral part of that approval process. So we're just inserting the Planning Commission back in. And you have that language, I think, attached.
It is attached.
Which we provided to Jerry Clark and the rest of the delegation last February, and they didn't think it was important enough to insert, and it passed either way. Exemptions is another piece of cleanup. I think Chris pointed out, we're going to be putting headings in the document so you can find your way through it. How do I pay my bill? What are the fees cost? What are the exemptions? There are probably 12 different exemptions scattered throughout Chapter 113. It's a heck of a time trying to find them. So we just have a section called exemptions, and we pulled them from every single area and put them in one section.
Consolidated them into one section.
So the biggest impact is going to be, I believe, some readability to this document, because it's a bear to read through.
Again, I think user-friendly, just trying to make it user-friendly. It's just, I think it's always been a very difficult section to read through.
It's going to be revenue neutral.
Revenue neutral.
Yes, revenue neutral. Yes, revenue neutral.
Revenue neutral.
I call it substantive neutral, just, you know,
yes,
it, yeah.
I think that's an important note, right? The spirit of the law is not changing.
Right. The spirit of the law is not changing. Substance is not changing. This, not, as opposed to what we did in the last legislative session, this is just a matter of trying to make this easier to use for the future and setting the table for future changes if we need to make them.
No pun intended, but you're bringing it down to a sense where common people can read this. I don't need a lawyer.
That's right. I'm trying to put myself
well,
out of a job.
You'll be able to find it easier.
Trying to put myself out of a job.
Well, there was a lot of cut and pasting and moving the text around, but you don't want an and an or inserted where it was an and. That changes the spirit. You can't make shall may. You can't say could and would. I mean, so as far as it being easier to read, it's going to be easier to follow, easier to understand, but you can't change a lot of the text or it starts raising a lot of red flags because you can unintentionally change meaning. That's why we have lawyers, but you can unintentionally change the meaning.
Lawyers always get a job. I think, and getting back to your question, Commissioner Hewitt, and that is like one of the big things too is adding a definition section to this. I mean, that's so the first thing you'll encounter is a new definition section for the terms. So you know if you have a question about what something means, you go right to 113.1. What does an EDU mean?
Yeah, what does that mean? And then also, what is METCOM responsible for? If you read the text, does it say anything about grinder pumps? Doesn't say anything about force mains? Doesn't say anything about manholes, fire hydrants? It's very limited. So we want to include all other appurtenances that have to do with water and sewer.
Sure.
And then making sure those terms are consistent throughout the statute.
No big deal.
I wouldn't say no big deal. I would just say it's important to this. A complaint that we had during the task force was all these things, that different references to terms that the task force didn't understand. Why aren't we fixing this?
No big deal at all.
And we'll have the opportunity to review it on both board level and also discuss it and send joint letters back up the road.
Any questions, commissioners? Either side? Thank you all very much.
My pleasure.
Okay, next we go right into new customer initiative. Bob Kelly and Christy Hollander on the Metropolitan Commission partnership for the information and understanding.
Hi, whatever you want to do. That sounds fine.
Okay, very good. So good morning, and thank you for an opportunity to come and update you a little bit. About a year ago, we came before you. We were specifically talking about GIS and what we were going to do, and we had all sorts of plans and all sorts of good ideas to move forward. And really, I would just say that we've made some significant progress. And I think what the citizens kind of expect government to be working together. Sometimes maybe that doesn't happen as much as we would like, but I would say that over the last year, that's really come true with the partnership between the Metropolitan Commission and St. Mary's County Government, specifically in the GIS area. So I just wanted to, for the purpose of citizens and maybe some new board members here, in a sense, the reality is for GIS, there's really three different areas, right? And I think if you think of building a house, a foundation. So St. Mary's County Government's kind of stepped up, and we handle the base layers, if you will, for the GIS, right? So that's the foundation. So the property boundaries, the center lines for the streets, hooks into the SDAT data, and I wish we had more plats in St. Mary's County so we could actually even refine that even more.
but we're working on that. And St. Mary's County government has taken through the commissioner's funding and consolidating GIS last year, right, into IT. We've taken significant effort into making sure that our base layers are updated and accurate as they can be. And that's going to be a continuous process, right? So we take information that we learned and information that we were reviewing for the Lexington Park Development District Master Plan, and we refine these base layers for that. We have a significant effort that's going on with the next gen 911 system, which is GIS based, and so we're doing extensive data comparison with the Verizon Annie Alley data and 911 calls coming in and trying to identify those addresses that aren't clearly identified in our GIS and fix those. And we're actually moving through the entire county. We started with Lexington Park Development District, but we're moving through the whole county trying to make sure that our base layers are as accurate as we can be. It's a long effort. I wish I could have reported that we're done with that after a year, but we're probably another 18 months out before that's completed. It's just a huge amount of work. But the good news is, in these types of partnerships that we have with Metropolitan Commission, you know, we've been sharing data over the last year. So the data that MetCom has given us, we're able to use that to improve our data, put it in the baseline, and now make it available to what I would consider a customer, right? A MetCom, the Board of Education, and that's real-time information. So that's the good news. The good news is that we're working together, we're sharing data, and it's not just one way, it's both ways. And so that's the foundation part, is the background, right? So that the foundation, that's everything is built on that, and the county's providing that. And so the next piece of it is, well those services and those the data that's being pumped out, if you will, being pumped out to the citizens. So we're making it available. So that data, like I said, that data is real time. It's real time changes for us. When we make a change to an address layer or a boundary on the base maps, that's available as soon as that the GIS technician hits save. That's available on our base maps, available to our customers. We took this in the last year. We've taken the initiative and through Mr. Erickson and the staff there. Twice a year, we're getting data dumps from MetCom, right? So it's like they're doing their work during the year, and then they dump that information to us, and that's kind of what's posted up here. So we have an agreement, we have an understanding, hey, what you're comfortable with us posting to the citizens. So this information is available to the citizens, where the sewer lines are, where the water lines are, where all the other stuff is that I really don't know what you guys do. But all that other stuff is that you guys, right, that Christy and George, that you guys have said, this is good information that the public can use. How good is that information that public can use? It's really good, because in some of those discussions through the Lexington Park Development District Master Plan discussions, this information was used to help with the plan. And isn't that's what we're supposed to be doing, right? We're supposed to be pulling data together to make good decisions and moving forward. So that's very, very positive. So that's our GIS. So we're making. So if you think about it, to take my little analogy there, the county's doing the foundation, and what the citizens see is kind of like the outside of the house. That's the drive-by, right? That's the public appeal. That's the of your home. But how MetCom is using that data is kind of the inside, the interior of the house. How many bedrooms there are? What does the living room look like? And Christy's going to look at that, share that a little bit with you. But so that's our GIS. But there's more. We're doing more than just GIS. And so I wanted to share a couple of things with you. So there's the county commissioners. You're familiar with the CIP sheets that we use. And IT and county government, we create a little application that allows finance to kind of manage those CIP sheets and present it to the commissioners, which actually, In a good way for helping you make those decisions, and then it ends up in the budget hand. It ends up in the budget book, right? So that program we've given to MetCom. They saw the final results and they saw the value of some of that information. So we've given that program, and we'll support it a little bit, make some changes. So in the future, basically MetCom, I believe it's the plan to use that application that county government
developed and with some modifications, they'll start to be using that for their CIP projects in the future. That's good, right? There's not a whole lot. You didn't have to go out and buy a piece of software. You didn't have to pay somebody to develop it. We had it. We identified a need. It was good. It worked for us, and now we shared it out. Similarly to board docs. So not really IT, not involvement with IT, but board docs has worked for the last 4 years with St. Mary's County government, and now I believe that's being implemented, being used for the Metropolitan Commission for your meetings, for the preparation of meeting agendas and stuff like that. So again, the benefit to the citizens are it's really the same look and feel. It doesn't, right? If they're looking at an agenda for the county commissioners, or if they're looking at an agenda or meetings or historical stuff for the Metropolitan Commission, it's the same thing, and that's good. There's a comfort with that for the citizens. And then a big effort that we've been doing in St. Mary's County government is a response to the Zucker report, how permits are processed and how we can better be more efficient and work with that. And it's involved many county government departments, proper departments, but a lot of the agencies, including Metcom, right, health department, and a lot of several other agencies. And quite frankly, there's some staff here at Metcom that has some experience with some of the new technology that we're trying to roll out, and your folks have stepped up and said, hey, we can help with some of the training and help implement some of that stuff. So again, it's just another situation of government, you know, two arms of government really kind of working together and coming as one, which I think the citizens should be the board should be very proud of, and the citizens actually benefit. So that's my update. So Christy, I'm going to step aside and hand this to you so you can say how you're doing.
Thank you. So as you said, I'm going to go over kind of what we're starting to get into on the GIS end. So that collaborative data that they've given us, we've taken it in and are now analyzing that to see potential customers. So right now we have pulled in the information from the county. We're also pulling in our billing information to see who are actually served. Along with categories, the CWSP categories, and then the water and sewer locations. And then we're hoping to eventually get the soil classifications and some information from the health department to kind of pull in where the septics are, where septics that maybe have issues are. So we're hoping to take that data, analyze it, and then hopefully at some point generate like a heat map type map showing us, you know, these are where the failed septics are. This is where maybe a capital project might be able to come in and serve a larger group of people. We're also using this data to help audit our billing system, kind of look through and make sure everything's looking good. And then it's also part of our asset management system, our CityWorks program that our board knows we're using. So this is kind of our first run of our analysis, just to kind of see what kind of data we can get out of it. So we've pulled in the base layers from the county, and when we've kind of overlaid our customer data. So on this slide, you can see the blue are our customers that are in our billing that are paying their bills and are served by water. And the tan kind of pink color are people that are not served, that have a structure, so they have a building that are within 200 feet of water facilities. And we can change that 200 feet to 1,000 feet to 500 feet. It's an easy swap out. So you can kind of see the spottiness of the connections. And then these tables show kind of the data that was pulled through when we did that analysis. So with the water, you can see there's about 1,200 people that are within 200 feet that have a structure that aren't connected. And again, this is just our first run of data, so there might be more or less, but we're just kind of trying to see where this can take us. So once we have all this data done, our hopes are to have an outreach to the customers and say, hey, you are within 200 feet or 100 feet, or you're abutting a water line. Would you want to connect? And then we have all these new incentives to help them connect, our Metcom incentives along with possible bay restoration funding. So that's kind of where we're going with this, hoping to get some more customers. As we found in the rate study, it's important for us at this point to get some growth in our EDU. So we're moving forward to try to get people connected without a, you know, required connection, them wanting to come forward and wanting to connect. Any questions?
Any questions?
Thanks.
I just have one question. Would the other public utilities use this information as well? They make use of this, such as Verizon, which might
go. Sure. Yeah, I mean, the more information you build into it, the better your data can be, the better your analysis can be. GIS is a very powerful tool, and you know, the more data that we get from the county, the better.
So they would not have to create.
I don't know what they have in terms of their. We have all of our water and sewer facilities in, or mm-hmm. most of them. I don't know where they're at in their realm of having their facilities in, but. Yeah, I mean, most of this data, at least from the county, can be pulled off of their website.
That's where they are.
That's so. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? This part? Thank you, Mr. Kelly, and thank you, Ms. Holliday, for
I'm
your
gonna stay up here.
I think you're going to be still
yeah,
on
I'm
the line
again.
Yeah,
I'm going to stand right here.
We have a capital improvements projects update. Mr. John Dietrich with Ms. Holliday.
All right, get me again. So we're going to go over, I think there's three projects now that are on the books that we're doing joint efforts to get complete. The first one being Patuxent Park, which you guys are all very well aware of.
I hear you holding us up. Yeah, what I was told.
So, like I said, we're getting near the end. We are currently working over here in phase four. Phases one, two, and three are now complete on the Metcom end. Our phase three kind of incorporates your guys' phase three and four. So right now, phase four, they had their notice to proceed on the end of last month, so they're getting ready to start construction with a completion date of next winter. It's about a year. And then we're also working with DPW. We had a small, I don't say issue, but we're trying to make sure our water main is out of their new paving section, so we're coordinating efforts to make sure that our water lines out of their paving so we don't have to go back in and tear up brand new paving to move forward with the next phase.
Thank you for that.
Thank you for that. Appreciate it.
So your goal is a year from now?
A year from now, our Metcom phase will be done. And then Johnson.
Then we can rebid our road construction.
I don't know what you guys is.
Okay.
And then John's gonna go over your guys' is.
Right. All right. First, I probably need to correct or at least amplify a statement I made in an earlier commission meeting. We adjusted our mutual schedules with Metcom based on funding availability. It's actually what happened. So that's exactly what happened. So
the deal was your money wasn't ready. That was the deal with.
No, we're fully funded. We've had our pre-construction meeting.
Well, it's when the money actually showed up, though, was what I use the D word, delay. Shouldn't use them. It was just an adjustment that we all have to do sometimes because sometimes the funding doesn't show up exactly when you need it. So, but we're in good shape right now. Marching along pretty good. So, Midway, we've got the base course down, curb and walk. If the rain will let up and the temperatures get above 45 degrees at the right day when we can actually get the paver on site, we could have the surface course on Midway, Card, and Wasp this year, which would be a major, major benefit. Saratoga, North Essex, the work's underway there. Again, we'd like to get the base course of asphalt done. Same problem. The rain needs to slow down a little bit, and we need to get that 45 degree temperature, make sure the surface temperature, all of that is above that. That's really the bare minimum. Ought to be 50, but we're hoping. That also will pertain to FDR when we get to that project. So. Section 1, Section 2, complete. Section 4, complete, Christy said. Section 3, we've got the design, of course, is done. We began work in spring of 2018.
and completion, shooting for absolute completion, trees planted, all of that done by spring of next year. Section 5, design on that will be complete next year, early spring, so that we can bid that project, get it underway in the fall of next year, and construction in the spring of 20, complete in the spring of 2021. So there it is in more of a graphic layout. Are there questions for either one of us on that project?
2.5 years on that St. Mary's side, finish this place up. You're talking 2021?
2021, right.
Man, those people have been going through a lot.
Mm. Right. It's actually a very difficult, complex project. I'm glad that I came in after it was already planned. And thank George. At any rate, Alan, the design engineer, is sitting back there. He can, if you have any other questions, be glad to take them.
Keep going ahead. Any questions, anybody?
All right, moving on. FDR, again, Alan is on the spotlight on that one. Design engineer on that. He'll be going, as soon as we finish here, shortly, Alan will be going to construction progress meeting for FDR, trying to figure out if we can get that that section, Amber Drive, down to Old Rolling Road open. And there's some real issues with the weather right now. And again, we need that 45 degree temperature and rising and the rain to stop. So.
And John, real quick, somebody pointed out to me that you got the lights working on that new section behind what they call Lowe's and
right.
Target and all that. But the lights that we actually use from Route 4 to where you get to make that turn, those lights don't work. Is there a reason? Look into that if you get a chance.
Yeah, look into that. There must be controls or something on that light.
It's kind of unique. So. It's dark because I noticed it after I was told.
Okay.
If you ride behind, I guess, Mr. Tire or whatever the
right.
place is off.
Right.
It might be due to some of this construction as well. I noticed it too. Right. So it could be.
Yeah, they might have hit something.
Oh, just right. Unusual to be on the side you drive on, it doesn't work, but on the side you can't drive on, it's all the way down.
Commissioner Hewitt, real quick, that's under First Colony's HOA that they have. The county actually doesn't maintain those sections of lights. However, we will get in touch with the First Colony HOA, that right. organization that they have that maintains that stretch of lights. So we will have to get in touch with them.
All right, so the dividing line between Phase 1 and Phase 3, the two that we're actively working on right now, is Chancellor's Run, as you all know. So, kind of zooming in on Phase 1, where the construction's going on right now, again, as I'm sure you all know, Phase 1B and Phase 1A, complete, substantially complete. Of course, phase 1A, as soon as we get the roundabout done at Old Rolling Road, we'll be able to, at any rate, the we'll get that section opened up and 1C completed where we're doing the culverts and so forth. All of that work will be done in the spring of next year.
And then for
can you salvage my presentation here?
And then for our Metcom phases, phase 1A and B are both complete. Phase C was just complete this fall. So for Metcom, The phase one, A, B, and C are all complete, along with phase two, which was, I believe, back this way.
All right, so phase three, that work is currently still under design. We've had a certain amount of problems in locating stormwater facilities that can handle both some of the private stormwater that from property that we're impacting with the project. So we're kind of in a joint effort with the fire department, for example, but also just all the impervious surface we're adding to the right of way. So some of the areas that we thought we were going to be able to use on the initial design got through the original clearance. Turns out they don't, they can't be used because of a connection with wetland or with the property needs of the adjacent owners. So the schedule on that, though, is the design is 95% complete. We still hope this year to be able to go to land acquisition, so that'll mean resolutions going to the commissioners for approval of that work. That'll mean an adjustment to our CIP program for both phases. That's going to have to happen this year on this project, and that'll. And so we'll be able to get both phases launched. Next year will be spent primarily in getting property easements. There's some right of way that has to be purchased, and will literally open the corridor up for Metcom to do any additional work that they want to do in that area. So at this point, construction starting in the fall of 2020 for phase one or 3B, the one that's furthest out, that the section to the right, and phase 3A will be started prior to that in the spring of 2020. They're both going to be 15 to 18 months in construction. So that should bring the projects to completion in early 2022. So
I'll just speak up since I started this thing 8 years ago. When I get done here, which is November something, 2022, I want that damn road done, please. But I want it done. I want to get my bicycle and ride all around the road.
Well, we're looking pretty good for that right now.
Where are you at on this land acquisition? That's always been the big bug to my saddle. We were supposed to have that done by July of this year, and we're nowhere near that.
No, we're nowhere near that. You're right. Again, it's the stormwater issues. There are, but prior to that, in the summer this year, some adjacent property owners came in with more demands for mitigations to their property, which we felt we really had to do more. And some of that actually shifted the alignment slightly, which that just kicks in a whole series of modifications to the plans. It's unfortunate that we didn't hear about some of these complaints earlier, but it's taken care of now. And again, right now, it's just the stormwater piece that's really in the way. We're very reluctant to go to the resolution to ask for the property acquisition until the design is done. There may be some pieces, though, that we might go out in advance, ask the commissioners whether we can purchase those. Alan and I are still working through that issue.
Mr. Dietrich, we just borrowed $10 million, paying 3.17% on it. And that money, I'm always a fan of you don't borrow it until you need it. Now, people say, well, interest rates could go up. But I'm still telling you this. Time is money. Because we have this money borrowed we can't use it for this project. And if we're sitting on it for 2 years, that's liable to cost taxpayers $600,000-$700,000. That's a lot of, or whatever. Whatever finance or whatever we got to do moving forward, if we don't borrow money before we need it.
Well, our finance director can give a little more detail to that. I'll just say, though, the money's been moved to other projects that need it more immediately so that the books balance and that we're not sitting on money. We don't get into the issue of interest on money that we borrow.
Okay, before we move forward, let me ask you guys something. Does this kind of budgeting, does this kind of scheduling of events also impact your scheduling, I would say?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, we have a CIB budget out through 5 to 10 years.
Right, for this, if we're talking about the section that is land acquisition on FDR Boulevard,
I would say anything that the county does is not falling in line with what we think it's supposed to happen. I would assume would have an impact on your project.
Sure, it will affect projects, but it affects rates. That's the big thing. Capital contribution charges and system improvement charges in the capital budget. So it impacts that as well.
The amount of outstanding debt. But we agree with your philosophy that borrow as needed, as close to when needed.
Yeah, I mean, I know it's not that exact science, but we had an idea we'd have land acquired by July of this year. And Lord
knows,
we missed that date. So
it would seem to me that there would be an opportunities for parallelized effort here, in which case you know some of the land you have to acquire, right? I mean, whether or not you have to acquire more of it for different stormwater facilities or others, I mean, I'm an action-oriented guy. I would just get rolling on by it, but that's me. It's not my budget.
I hear we have to have design all pretty much squared away before we can actually acquire. So that makes sense, too. You don't want to acquire unless you need it.
You know where the road's going. They've known where the road's going for 10 years.
A couple feet here, a couple feet there.
You need plats. You need plats, and you need appraisals, and they have to be square footage based.
I guess where I'm going with this, a more coordinated effort on our scheduling of and when we can do stuff and your scheduling could impact your ability to have money available for other stuff, too.
Absolutely.
If we're not ready for you guys.
We have to plan our borrowing appropriately, that's for sure. We're not just borrowing ahead of time. We're going to wait to see how the master schedule works out and work our schedule within the master schedule.
Yeah, and we talk when we do our CIB with Alan and people over at DPW to make sure our projects are lining up, and I think we just had that discussion recently about this project. So we are coordinating in that effort.
And on FDR, I think the county may be considering moving that out, but we're going to keep it in line because whether we do a joint venture or not, we want to be in a position to bid. We just won't borrow the money. So we'll have the budgetary authority, but we won't have received a loan.
I'm a supporter of this project, to be clear. I think the sooner the better on getting every section of it.
Everybody is a supporter of it. We just need to get it done.
It'll increase commerce on 235 between FDR and here.
I think we're all here with you on that one. Does anyone got you on that?
Let's open it up.
So a big problem is acquisition of the property.
Well, finishing the design is the biggest problem, and Alan and I again are talking about ways to accelerate the property acquisition. Right now, the plan all along has been we'd use SHA to do all the property acquisition. I've been talking to the county attorney about potentially using some of his contracts to kind of help out with that and speed it up and. Again, maybe do some of those early ones. Yeah.
That's always a holdup, I know that. Like the circle we did at Plymouth, there was a big holdup on land acquisition, almost a year. So whatever we can do to speed that process up, let us know.
All right, so for Metcom phase A and B, or 3A and B, we're as the county, we're following kind of in suit. We're under design and just about done. And 3A is scheduled to begin, which is just north of Buck Hewitt, with the Buck Hewitt being the kind of dividing line. 3A beginning construction hopefully in the spring of 2020, and then 3B following the fall of 2020 to match the counties. Any additional questions on FDR?
Anything else, Kevin?
All right.
Thank you all very much.
Oh, we'll have to pick up one more.
One more.
One more. This one will be quick.
Yeah.
So this one's very very similar, a protected park. It's a revitalization project. Infrastructure built in the 40s. It just needs to be replaced and upgraded. So right now, we have design for phase one, which is this kind of front section, to begin next winter, with the construction in the fall. And then phase two, which would be this back section, construction to begin in 2023. This rear section, the red, it's a grinder pump force main area. We most likely won't have a phase three. We'll probably do that under a separate project and just replace the grinder pumps because the lines and everything seem to be probably in all right shape.
Chrissy, a question of, is that still a single feed coming down 235 to Southampton? There's no other connections going across any other place?
No, sir.
That's bad.
We can look at it when this project comes through and see if we can do some looping.
I mean, from a resilient standpoint, if you have a failure on that line coming out 235, you got nothing in Southampton. Mm-hmm. You got a single point failure. And I'm just saying, I think we should look at that. That's
sure.
From my...
We can definitely look at that when the engineering comes up.
That's a similar thing that I want to talk to Mr. Erickson more about, just whether our projects can help facilitate looping for them in the future in other areas of the county. Airport, for example, is a perfect example of that. So, at any rate, make it quick here, Southampton project. Design will start next year, the fall of next year. Construction will follow all the way through phase three. It's just one, you know, the knee bone's connected to the shin bone all the way through, and we will be out of this neighborhood in the spring of 2026. So that'll pretty well wrap it up. As we go through the design, there may be ways to get through faster, and we'll try to deal with that as we face it.
I have a question for you. Totally removed from this, which will be near dear Mr. Fairfax. Last couple of years, we've been waiting to pay South Shangri-La from Essex, from Willis to Essex, whichever way you want to look at it. And we've been delayed for a couple of years because MECOM has some, experiencing some, I guess, pipe breaks, something like that back in there. Is there any hope that those things will get fixed or repaired so we can repave that road back by Bay District and the library and the housing projects back in there?
Yeah, we'll take a look at that. Is it on your repaving schedule?
2 years ago. So we're just waiting for you guys. They said it's a MECOM issue with some of the failures you have in lines and things like that. Thank you.
First.
Any other questions?
Any other questions, David? Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Very good. I think that's all of our presentations. Unless y'all have something else?
No, I think good.
Well, it's been, I think, a very productive meeting. Thank y'all very much for participating. And the President Board and Mr. Erickson are doing a good job of moving forward with the projects. Like I said, we just need more customers. We'll do everything to help you get that for us, whatever it takes to do that.
Pleased to see. Congratulations on all your re-elections. I will miss Commissioner Darbo, his replacement. I'm sure will come right up to speed. But it's nice to have some continuity of leadership and some strategic direction for the county and working closely together. So I think it's a productive partnership.
And we'll continue that. We haven't got many complaints at the Commissioner Board about MetCom, so that's good. Like we first got elected, we had a lot of complaints. So something's running smoothly here. We appreciate all the work y'all have done. Productive 4 years. At that time, since we are finished our meeting here tonight, today, I'm not tonight yet, today, thank you very much. May I adjourn.